let's check the mic, see if everything is flying.
You got it.
And I'll watch the video.
Okay. Let's check.
Pizza and fruit pies.
Test, test. March Madness.
Test, test, test.
Three, Mike, three. Gracias.
Oh, I have many great St. Patrick's Day jokes.
What's it? Yes, let's hear them.
What do you get when you cross poison ivy with a four-leaf clover? A rash of good luck.
Oh, that's a good one. I like it.
Why don't you ever iron a clover?
Iron? I don't know.
You don't want to press your luck.
Oh, that's great.
These are gold.
Those are good. Right, you got to make sure you break those out. I'm going to move it over here. Oh, that's a shame. What else? What else?
No, that's just that's offensive.
It.
What's
no offensive.
What's Irish and stays out all night?
Every guy in a pub? I don't know.
Patio furniture.
Oh, God. All right, that's a good one.
That's a good one.
Patio furniture.
So I heard, I don't remember who was telling me, but so the St. Baldrick's thing is like all week.
Yeah.
And they block off the street, and it's like a big deal.
Well, because they're doing one at De Vere's, which I think they did yesterday.
That was yesterday.
Yeah.
Okay.
So
whoever
I
was talking
one.
To went to that.
That's a big one. They're doing one of these days at Children's Hospital in Oakland.
Oh, wow.
That's a new participant this year with our organization. So,
okay.
Yeah, they do a bunch of them. They used to do them with the Kings and the Rivercats, but I believe they're not doing those anymore.
Oh.
Yeah.
Well... It's a big old deal.
Yeah, it's
shut
a huge
down
deal.
The street or the whole
yeah.
block.
Yeah, yeah, because the DeVere's
had a thing.
They're
yeah,
they're big supporters of it.
Makes sense.
I think Bell Brothers has been big supporters, and I think they're doing their own thing in Elk Grove. I think.
Oh, nice. That was like one of my very first jobs.
Bell Brothers.
I worked for Pizza Bell.
Oh, Pizza Bell, really?
I was a manager. It's very, very
nice.
Fancy.
Which Pizza Bell?
The one in Elk Grove that was on like whatever that was, right by Sheldon High School.
Yeah,
that was everything. And then I hired my husband to be the delivery driver. And then I gave him all the best deliveries. So he had to get the best.
Nice. How long were you there?
Oh, I don't know, like a year? Like whatever, my senior year of high school. We had quite the little operation.
I bet. No, where'd you go to high school?
Well, 2 years in Kansas and then 2 years out here in Shelby.
Well, Shelby. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. So it was in your neighborhood.
Yeah. Which my sister claims that she got me that job. So she's 6 years younger than me, right? So she had to be like 10. And they would like ride their bikes down there and go get a soda. And she came back and was like, they're hiring and I put in a good word for you.
A good word.
I'm like, okay.
That did it.
Thank you. That was a fun time.
That's funny. How many hours did you work?
I think every weeknight or
I worked at a restaurant in high school called the Golden Egg Almond House.
Ooh.
We did breakfast and lunches, so it was get there every Saturday and Sunday. I worked at like 5:30, go till 2. You do sandwiches and stuff, lunch, but they had 100 different kinds of almonds, and then lunches, and then they started selling beer and wine at one point for the lunch crowd.
Okay.
So, tap beer and then wine, and then they tried evenings for a while.
Yeah.
My mom would house at the end.
It's tough.
Over well. Because they do like steamed vegetables. So
right.
Just,
no, my first job was in Kansas. It was a Chinese restaurant, but the people were Vietnamese.
Nice.
And.
But not Vietnamese food.
Not Vietnamese food. Chinese food. And I was a waitress. I was like 14, 13 or 14, whatever. I was a waitress.
In Kansas, they can hire you at 14, huh?
Yes. And I made $4.15 an hour.
Sweet.
I remember that.
And plus tips.
Plus tips. So, and the lady that ran it had lived in the U.S. like 20 years, and she refused to speak English. Like, she did, she just wouldn't.
She was good.
Yeah. And then she would yell at you. And I remember, like, they start you on, like, the buffet or whatever, like, whatever. And you do drinks, and you do rice, and you do whatever. And then they teach you how to do the soups. So I come in, and it's like, you know, these two big, like, water tank, whatever,
yeah.
steamer
yeah.
tank. Here's how you do the soup. You just turn it on, like... So We don't, like, this is just the soup that was already in here? Yeah. So how long would this soup be in here? It's like, you just add more to it. So, like, when it comes to it, you just keep adding to it. Like,
never.
I've eaten here.
I've eaten that soup.
And then, in the back, there was, like a RV thing. And so it was like, okay, I don't know. Like, maybe they live in it. I have no idea. So one day, one of the guys in the kitchen, who, like, also refuses to speak any English, said, I need to go get something out of there. So I'm like, okay, whatever. So I go back, and I open the door, and it is, like, just the temperature. I mean, there's no heating and cooling in there, and there's just meat, like, hanging from the things, like in an old RV. I'm like, again, I have eaten this food.
I've eaten this food.
And nobody died.
Life in the heartland. Good morning, everyone. Welcome to Beyond the Numbers. It is Wednesday, the 14th. March. I am your host, Mark Bellows, a tax principal with Clifton Larson Allen, a national CPA firm with offices throughout the U.S. and one here in Roseville. I work on manufacturers and distributors, real estate investors and developers, contractors, the owners, their businesses, that type of stuff. So planning, strategy, all that. And we are busy. It's that time of year. My co-host, Amanda Blackwood. Hello.
Hello, hello, everyone. Amanda Blackwood, managing partner, OE Consulting Group. We are change management consultants who recently have found a little niche in helping people move locations. So it's been really interesting.
Office locations?
Yeah.
In
like,
what way?
Because the time of moving like brings up all of these organizational design and development questions. Like who will we be in this new space? How is this, you know, speak to our vision and how will we work together? And do we want collaborative space or open space, you know, whatever. So it's been like a really weird little niche.
How did you guys start?
We realized we were doing it and then met with an architect and they said, you know, they had some internal stuff they needed help with, but said, this is something our clients deal with all the time, is they're planning on being, and they do big, big moves. So they're planning on being in this new space and they want to re-envision who they are and how they work. So we started talking to other architects. Is this something you guys run into as well? And they said, yeah. And then conversations with brokers that are trying to get people into space. And they're like, it would be really great if folks knew what they were looking for, you know, prior to looking. Like, you know you need to move because we're scaling or we're, you know, whatever, we're combining teams, we're merging, whatever. But who do we want to be? And how do we want that to feel? And what's our culture? So we help folks kind of figure that out in the beginning. So it, you know, speeds up the process for brokers and, you know, architects aren't doing designs that nobody wants. And, you know, and then people find space and they get going right away, so. Weird how you're bit, you know? Weird how business...
You had not planned on doing that type of consulting.
Had not planned it, but it is a niche, and we're national, and nobody else is doing that work, so...
Interesting.
Interesting times for OE Consulting Group. So if you're in that situation, look us up, www.oeconsultinggroup.com, and we will have a combo.
Awesome.
Are you ready?
I'm ready, yes.
Are you ready?
We have a guest today. Rachel is on her way in. Those of you in this area know that what it's like out there on the road. So she's on her way in, but in the meantime, Amanda's got some great St. Patrick's
Day. Okay, guys.
So
all right. I have three good ones. I'm going to save the best for last.
Okay, good.
All right. What do you get when you cross a pillowcase with a stone?
Pillowcase with a stone. What do you get?
A shamrock.
Oh, jeez. All right.
Okay.
That's a really good one.
Okay, all right. All right. We'll go with number two.
Number two, yes.
What do you get when you cross poison ivy and a four-leaf clover?
Poison ivy and a four-leaf clover. Boy, I don't know what's that one.
A rash of good luck.
Oh, that's great. Plus and minus. Okay.
Okay.
They're just getting better.
Okay, and this is my favorite. This is my very favorite. You can take this one with you. Share this with the kids.
Okay.
What is Irish and stays out all night?
What is Irish and stays out all night? Besides guys in pubs, I don't know. But...
Patty, oh, furniture.
Oh, that's good. Patio furniture.
Patio
furniture. That's good.
All right. Enjoy that, guys.
Thank you, Amanda.
You're
That's
welcome.
Great.
Happy St. Patrick's Day.
So are you seeing a trend in one or the other in terms of either open space or what kind of trends are out there? We see this.
That is a great question. So a lot of folks, it's like, well, this is what Google's doing, and this is what Facebook's doing, and we need this open space, right? Which is really cool when you think about it, and aesthetically it's cool. But you've got to think about the way you work and what's true to your team. I'll give you a little case study. I was working with a client, and they had built office space in like a big, long kind of hallway with like open in the middle, but long on the side with a whole bunch of little offices. And they had way more staff than they had planned for. So you had 2-3 people crammed into these office spaces, which was difficult. So the owner was like, guys, I'm going to work with this architect, and we're going to create this new space, and it's going to be like co-working and open, and we'll flex space, and we'll have these little pods and whatever. But we basically had to blow out all the offices to be able to do that. Well, he was really excited about it. Spent about $40,000 on architect and engineering and city and whatever, presenting it to the team, and they were so offended because they're like, by the nature of our work, we have to have private conversations. This is legal. This is compliance. Our ownership doesn't even know what we do.
Yeah.
You know, you right? So it opened up this whole and there's this you know, when you're going through that space, there's something to be said for when you're in an office, it is like you have made it.
Yes.
Right? You've moved from the cube to the office, you have a door.
Oh yeah. Yeah.
You know, it really speaks to you. So when you take that away, CEOs don't care, right? They're not thinking about things like that.
Right,
but your managers, it's a big deal to them.
Yeah.
So, you know, it's just kind of like those things you need to think about. And do I need a communal space that causes kind of organic collisions and conversations? You know, do we do that in our lunch space? Do we want to have a bar? Like, you know, what kind of environment do we want to think? So, you know, for trends, it's really cool to see all that new stuff and that we totally work and that we totally be true to the vibe and the values that you have. Or it may not.
Yeah.
You know, and people need private space, and that just is what it is, and you need to plan for that.
Yeah, it really, and I think it depends, like you say, on the business and what you do. I know that with CPA firms, you know, the old model, with I think law firms and those types of other professional services, the old model was, for a long time, you know, offices on the outside, cubes in the middle, right? And then some time ago, they all went to trying to change that up. So let's move offices in the middle and cubes on the outside and open spaces, and then now my understanding is it's all kind of going back to offices on the outside, cubes in the middle, and so.
Right. And that flex space option that do you want to have events? Do you want to whatever? Yeah. So put all those desks on wheels and you can push them out of the way. And
we just built a big, we call it the CLA Cafe, which other offices throughout the U.S. have as well. And it has a lot of collaborative space, a big open space for, that's kind of where our kitchen is. And people can gather there for meetings and stuff. Also small little workspaces, a couple rooms you can close off, some standing, just even desk options.
Yeah.
But then you still have the offices and the cubes. So.
Yeah, it's interesting.
It's very interesting.
Yeah, it's, you know, it's change management. And it's hard. I mean, if you're moving, you know, 3,000 employees, you can't ask everyone their opinion.
No.
But there has to be a mechanism to do, are we meeting your needs? And are we in touch with how you work and what you're looking for? And, you know, you've got folks that sit at a desk all day. Well, they are probably the ones that need the windows. You know, executive that you're only going to spend 2 hours in there. It says a lot to your staff that you understand their experience.
Right.
So,
And, you know, I mean, study after study after study show that salary is not the driving force always.
Right.
Quite often, it's not even the main or secondary.
Right.
And it's benefits and it's things, you know, aesthetics and that type of stuff that people's environment that they're working in. So
yeah.
That can have a huge difference.
Yeah. Engagement work.
Yeah.
Happy people, more productive people.
Right.
Who doesn't want that?
I know. Well, if they want to get hold of you to talk about that with someone's client, what's the best way to get hold of you?
Go to the website, www.oeconsultinggroup.com, or you can always shoot me a call or text, 916-708-6061.
Great. All right, we're going to take a commercial break. When we get back, we'll bring on our guests. You listen to Beyond the Numbers.
Hi guys!
Hi,
you know, I'm only like 20 minutes late.
No
totally
worries.
Fine.
Jesus.
You say it. Good to see you.
You too.
You made it.
Jeez.
Made it.
I was like, oh, I'm so good. I'm gonna be like 20 minutes early. And then as it began to get closer, I was like, shit, Mom, I gotta go. Like, I'm gonna be late.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not even sure how I'm gonna get a hold of them to let them know I'm late.
It's all good.
And then you have water.
Yeah. Facebook Live there. Perfect. So we'll go right now. Okay. And then Jerry will let us know when we're back on. So let's be known. And then when there's, cool. he gives me fingers, so that's when we know how much time's left. So
okay.
I'm doing fingers.
I remember like before gangs. Being like, whoa,
yeah.
all of a sudden things just changed. So you can see the fingers.
On the show before, right?
Yeah.
How long ago was that?
I want to say it was like Rick? Yeah, with Katie.
Okay.
And it was
so
like 6-8 months ago.
Okay.
Oh, okay.
Ish.
Yeah.
Yeah. This morning I was thinking you'd been on before.
Yeah.
I thought so.
Yeah.
So.
We did something around women, you know, women in the workplace, all that good stuff. It was good.
Can you hear?
Is this a prank?
It's not important.
It's extra.
We're back. You're listening to Beyond the Numbers. Jerry, who is that? Awesome.
Nice.
Nice. All right. Throw an old one in there. I like it. We have you in older ones when you get to the normal one. Anyway.
Moving on.
Listen to Beyond the Numbers. Our guest this morning, Rachel Zillner with Safe Credit Union.
Yes.
Hi, how are you? Good morning.
I'm great. I'm here.
Yay.
Yeah, you're the VP of Community Banking and Membership.
That's
with Safe Credit Union.
Yes.
And a veteran of the show.
Yes.
Yes.
But a veteran by twice.
Yes, second time on. We like having repeat guests.
Great.
It means we liked you the first time. So
well, thank
and
you.
And you have like 7 other businesses since the last time you were on. So there's so much to talk
yeah,
about.
I know. Well, maybe tell our listeners a little bit about who you are in
sure.
your own words, Rachel.
Okay, well, that's always a fun question to be asked, right?
Yeah, right.
We'd like it in the form of haiku, please.
Oh, God.
Yeah, please.
We might be waiting for too long for that. We have to think about it.
Or a limerick.
A limerick.
That would have been more appropriate.
Yes, for St. Patrick's Day.
Faster, right? So, hi, I'm Rachel Zillner. My day job is Vice President of Community Banking and Membership with Safe Credit Union. I've been there for 12 years and was with Golden One for 7 years prior to that. Totally a credit union kid. Love the credit union space. Like, it helps me sleep at night, seriously. Outside of that, since I was 20, I've been investing in real estate. So my husband and I run our own, you know, residential property investment space. And then this year, I decided to get my real estate license to do my own real estate transactions. So I've done 2 now so far, which is great. And let's see, we also own Beat the Room. My husband, my brother, and I are partners in an escape room business where we opened in Rockland, and now we have a second location in Vacaville. And coming later this year, we'll be expanding in Rockland. So,
awesome.
You know, lots of good things going on. I'm also a mom, 2 kids, 3 and 5. I have an incredible husband and a dog. That's my life.
Wow.
In a nutshell.
That's a full life.
Yeah.
Right?
Stay busy.
Yeah. So what type of real estate do you guys invest in?
Residential property. Generally looking at single family homes. Anything that's you can rent for around $1,500 or less. I figure that market's always going to be busy, so I don't have to worry about having non-occupancy issues. So we keep them full.
So clients, I have a number of clients that also invest in the ones that don't have a team doing the scouting, they do their own scouting, tell me stories of how many properties they look at before they finally find the one that they can buy. So what has been your experience?
In fact, I had a wonderful real estate agent before I decided to take out the middleman. But we would look at 30 to 50 properties before I'd find one that say, yep, this is right, kick the tires and I like it. But, you know, it's a fun game because once you find what you want, you got to move rather quickly.
Right.
Mm-hmm. So there are a couple of times where we bought a property before my husband ever even saw it, right? Because I was the one with the more flexible schedule out there kicking tires, like this, now. Okay, we got the keys. You want to see it, honey? Let's see what we bought.
What'd you do today?
Well, you know, most women pick up shoes, right? And bring them home. Look what I got. I'm like, I got a house.
I bought a 3-2.
Yeah.
That's great. So how many doors do you guys have now?
7.
That's great.
Yeah, we do some math.
Do you do it generally Sacramento area? Or?
Yeah, always greater Sacramento area because we're managing them ourselves,
right.
So we can, you know, get to them. But we're holding out for 2021, so we've sold off a couple, and we're you know, no one wants to hope for the next big, you know, bust. But looking at trending, we're well overdue for it. So
Yeah, I'm hoping for that. I'm renting right now. I'm praying that the market crashes.
Do you think 2021 is going to start coming back up, or that's going to start buying?
I think it's
going
to be the down. Okay. I mean, and I don't make these things up myself. I'm certainly not an economist by any trade. But
so that disclaimer out there,
like,
Rachel's not an economist. Okay.
Not even close. But you hear Visa started saying that. Lots of different economists are kicking it out there. And so I'm feeling pretty good about that.
All right.
So am I. Coming for you, ESAC. I will buy a 3-bedroom house.
Awesome.
In a couple of years.
Yeah, in a couple of years. I can wait.
In the time
is
right.
I'll write it out.
Yeah.
Just upgrade it now, please.
There you go.
I like white subway tile in the kitchen. Okay. That'd be great.
Well, so you started to get investing when you said you were younger.
Yeah, I bought my first house when I was 20. And I learned, I mean, I was so lucky. Like, my dad, I remember him taking us on this drive when I was like 15 or 16, maybe younger. I don't know. I swear I don't remember anything before I was like 12. So everything is just pushed into that space. But my dad took us on this drive to all these different neighborhoods in Sacramento. And when we would get into like the apartments and some not so great areas, my dad would say, "Look at the cars, kids." And we'd look and there were some really nice cars, right? Like all super, super nice cars. And then he'd take us to like suburbia. Not like super high income, just like plain old Sacramento suburbia. And he'd say, "Look at the cars." And they were all like older Hondas, older Toyotas, little trucks. And he's like, "Well, what's the difference?" Well, you know, obviously you can see that. But his point was, you know, make the investment in a home instead of in a car.
Right.
So I took that advice at a young age and decided that one of my best friends at 18 bought a brand new Toyota Celica, and her car payment, when I did the math as a teller on the computer, was the same as a mortgage.
Wow.
So I got her. So I said, "Well, hey, if they'll qualify her for a car, I could probably get a house, right?" And sure enough, it worked. So I got my first one at 20.
That's great.
Yeah.
That's a great story. And you know, it ties into how important, you know, being taught things as a youth growing up, which ties into the last week's show with junior achievement.
Mm-hmm.
The importance of that, you know, so. It's good to hear someone's story like that where it made an impact. So.
Yeah, financial education is the real deal.
Yeah.
It's not something that we teach. I mean, I'm sure Susan talked all about
that last week.
it's a big problem in our nation, here locally. The only place you learn really is from the School of Hard Knocks. So we've all been there.
Mm-hmm.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
So real estate investing is one thing you guys do. Now, do you buy them and then rent them out, or do you renovate, or what have you done in the past?
We always put money into every property we buy. So, you know, people joke about the whole slumlord thing, but, you know, we couldn't be further from it. Every house we buy, we immediately upgrade and add in ceiling fans, fix up kitchen, paint floors, whatever it is. So something that we could say, I would feel safe living here with my family or my children. And then we prefer to just sit on them, because this is supposed to be the passive retirement income that we can take. As soon as we can replace our income, then we have the choice to say if we want to retire or if we want to keep on working. But sometimes it's really hard to not turn that house over when you bought it for $68,000 and it's worth $200,000, right?
Oh, sure,
so
sure.
There's quite the, if we could sell this one, maybe we could buy two when the market crashes again. Will it ever look like 2009 again?
Right.
I don't think it will, but we'll see.
Well, I think one of the important things in investing is to when you have a plan and a course, to stay the course.
Yes.
You know, I think because it's quite often people get off the course and then it goes south.
Yeah,
so
absolutely.
If the course is not to sell it, then
you gotta stick with it.
Yeah.
We made decisions as we've learned, right? Because you started young and again, you learn as you go. But I actually had a great airplane conversation with Kip Blewett from RoomCon. And he does a lot of commercial property investments, so I was giving him my business plan, and he said, I felt so special. He's like, "This is like the best business plan I've ever heard." And I was like, "Well, thanks, Kip." Like, you know, like, this dude knows what he's doing, and I'm just messing around over here, so this is great. But because of that, he gave us some great advice, which was, you know, don't keep the properties that you have an HOA attached to them, because that's an animal that can rule over you, right? Like, you have no say-so.
Right.
And he was so right. We've been fed so many times from, you know, the condos that we had where, you know, a renter carried their Christmas tree out and there were pine needles, and so they feed us. Or their cat bent a, you know, whatever these are called, blind. And it was like, I'm so tired of getting the cat messed with the blinds. So it's like, cats are not evil. They're just cats, you know, but they keep charging you $45 every time the cat looks out the window.
Right.
So dropping those properties was really great advice.
Is that right?
Yeah. And plus the HOAs just continue to go up. And right. How are you going to fend against that when they just, and you have no control over it?
Yeah.
Unless
yeah.
you want to sit on every HOA council, right? No, thank you.
Yeah. Yeah.
I don't have time for six or seven of those. Right?
No, no, yeah. It's better special to do other things. So, and you guys manage the property yourselves.
We do.
Properties yep. yourselves.
Yes.
So, does that mean late night calls when the toilet's stopped up?
You know,
for instance.
I think folks who own property or are looking at that for investment property are usually afraid of that.
Yeah.
And if that's not your thing, then you definitely don't want to manage your property. But I find, okay, so this year we have one tenant who doesn't ever pay his rent on time, which is annoying, but that's why we have a late fee, right?
Yep.
And we follow the process every time. We have to give him notice that you gotta pay. And then the only other phone call I've had so far this year was, hey, there's something on the beam in the ceiling, and we went to go check it out thinking, oh gosh, the roof, and I just had put a new roof on that house. No, it's a bird, and like a bird burrowed into some wood, and it's, you know, using that as a nest. So we just gotta evict the bird instead of the tenants, which is a much easier process in California.
Much easier. Yeah,
yes.
Sure.
3-day notice to the bird.
Right. Get out, buddy.
That, and you bring up a good point about the evicting tenants.
Yeah.
I mean, have you had yet?
Quite a few times.
And,
yeah.
And it's
actually
difficult. Do you have to bring in an attorney? Or
no.
Can you? Okay, well, good.
I have not had to go to that. I have had to go to court, us going to court before.
Yeah.
Most of the time, and these are probably not good things to say out loud, but most of the time when we get into a situation where the tenant's, you know, deposit isn't enough to cover the damage, when I look at that, if it's not more than a couple thousand, it's not worth our time
right.
to take them to court. So we take it as a loss.
It's unfortunate that's how it is.
Yeah, but it doesn't happen that often. You know, most people are generally good people. You know, you if you find a good tenant who's going to be there for a while, which is, we've learned, we had a lot of bad tenants. Actually, my first house, the house I got when I was 20, once I moved out and turned it into a rental, I rented it to a family who rented out the garage to another family who rented out the attic to another guy, right? So lesson learned. And then brought in another family that, like, they were sharing the lease with their children. And that first weekend, like, we signed the lease, it's supposed to be executed. One of the tenants pulled a gun on the other tenant and now was in jail. So they wanted him taken off the lease. And I was like, wow, what are we going to do about this?
Yeah.
Right? So eventually it turned into, all right, guys, this isn't working out. Someone
yeah.
here needs to decide who's going to live there and who's not. And,
yeah.
and they decided to move out.
Yeah.
So, so, you know, we use a different screening process.
Yes, I know you do.
Yes. Makes it a lot easier.
Nice.
Yeah.
Well, I want to hear about the puzzle room thing and how that even became...
Yeah.
Like, why did you do that? Did
no,
you
I mean,
go,
they,
you know?
And
like,
they're big.
Yeah.
They're big now.
They're so cool.
Yeah.
They are. Yes. I mean, I'm not biased or anything. But yeah.
And yours is clearly the best.
Well, yeah.
Obviously, in my world, mine's the best. But actually, there are 15 in Sacramento. So here's the story. So we were traveling on, you know, like, vacation, which we actually, believe it or not, take vacation
wow.
sometimes.
Nice.
And we were out on the East Coast, and we had one of those days, right, where you're on vacation, you're like, I don't want to do anything, right? Like, I'm going to just wake up and do whatever I want. Well, that was the most boring day ever, because we had no clue what to do. So I did one of those, like, TripAdvisor searches, like, things to do, you know, and up popped an escape room. So I said to our foursome, hey, guys, do you want to do an escape room? I heard about these. They're pretty cool. And they were like, eh, no, like, I mean, I'm not doing anything else. Come on, anyone want to do that? All right. Anybody super not want to do this? No response. Great. I booked it. Told my brother, you owe me $60. You know, so we played our escape room a couple hours later. It was a blast. Like, so much fun. We just had a total blast. Came out a couple days later. We're all at dinner. My brother says, what was everyone's favorite thing on the trip? Like, hands down, the escape room. We should open one of these. This is amazing. Like, I get crazy. Like, my brain just went. My husband's like, hold on, kid, you know, because he just can't let me go. It's dangerous.
Well, we're going to take a break.
Yep, take a break.
And when we get back, we'll continue the conversation. We'll learn more about how the puzzle room went from idea to
implementation.
Operation.
Yeah.
Listen to Beyond Numbers.
All right. I love this song.
Is that right?
Yeah. It's the kind of stuff my dad and I used to rock, too.
60s. Well, not in, I was in the 60s, but the music's from the 60s. Right?
That's so awesome. Your dad did that.
Yeah, that is great. That is so cool.
I don't even know what compelled him to do that, but it's definitely stuck with me.
That's a great example.
I'm like, I need to make my really kids do that, right? Drive them around.
Did you just see that?
Yeah. Unexpectedly, right? Like, I don't know if he pre-scouted it or what, because it's very easy to find neighborhoods that don't fit that.
What's an escape room?
An escape room? Have you ever done, like, a murder mystery dinner before?
A long time.
Okay. So imagine a murder mystery dinner, but you're inside of a locked room, and you have an hour to solve the puzzles that are in the room. So you work with your friends and other people that are in the room to solve the puzzles and beat the room. It's very fun.
It is really fun.
It's super fun.
Yeah.
We did one.
I guess I have to have a bottle of scotch to enjoy.
Afterwards.
Some of the people we did ours with, I think, had a bottle of scotch before they did.
Oh, God.
We did it with us. There were six of us and then another group, so like 10 of us all together.
Oh,
so
yeah.
Before you could have a few drinks before you got
there. Yeah. Yeah.
It was fun. It was a lot of fun.
Yeah.
It's our first time doing it. So.
Yeah, they are addictive. Right? Like, I feel like it's going to the movies, except you actually get to engage with one another, right? Like,
yes.
It's around the same price point by the time you get through all this stuff.
Yeah.
But then you're challenged by it, and you just keep thinking about it, you know?
Yes.
And it's great for relationship building. I don't care if it's you and your spouse, or you and your friends, or you with your kids, or your work team, or whatever, but it's, like, very memorable. You'll laugh about it for months to come, you know? It's pretty cool.
Yeah, it really is.
Yeah. Challenge. There's now this new thing that's coming out. Well, it's not new. It's new here. It started in Asia, where instead of escape room, it's like a bunch of tiny competition rooms, and you play the first room for like 15 minutes, and then if you beat it, you get to move on. If you beat it, you get to move on.
Oh.
Until somewhere in the segment you fail, and you have to exit.
Oh.
Yeah, which is kind of like, it has a repeat play piece to it, right? Where you keep on going. I think it's amazing. But, you know, it's a lot of square footage, and we are in California.
It'd be a lot of square footage.
So, I'm just saying, I don't know about here, but...
Wheatland!
Yes! There is an escape room in Yuba City. They're pretty phenomenal.
Is that right?
Yeah, NorCal Escape. They were the first one in our region.
Huh.
They're brothers. They're great guys. And yeah, they work their tails off.
Huh.
Yeah.
That's interesting. I feel like I would just geek out on the making of the puzzles. Like, to the point where they would become, like, so difficult.
Yeah, no, I want to hear about the whole process, because that is... I mean, the one we did is really... It was very creative.
Sure.
So, like,
which one did you play?
It was the one... I think it's in Roseville.
Okay, Quandary.
And it was...
Upstairs in Old Roseville?
Trump's America.
Oh, okay. Yes.
I think it was downstairs.
Yes, I know which one you're talking about.
I mean, that was very creative.
Yes.
That was fun.
It is.
Really fun.
I forgot,
ideas.
You're a Republican, and you played. Was it offensive?
I'm actually.
Oh, okay.
Earmuffs.
Earmuffs.
No, I don't know if anyone was offended on that one.
Yeah.
That they said.
I was trying to talk to some of our guests about that room, because it's such a, you know, it was such an amped up title.
Yeah.
And I had people get so angry. I was like, I'm not telling people about that escape room anymore.
I think the title had the potential to offend. I mean, the game had, I mean, it had some funny, did you do that one?
I have not.
Like, it did some funny gags on Trump himself, but
it
wasn't like, I don't think it was like,
offensive.
He's evil, we need to, you know, it was just, it was built around
the dance
trying to get
around
out.
It appropriately.
Yeah. We're back. You're listening to Beyond the Numbers with your hosts, Mark Bellows and Amanda Blackwood, and our guest today, Rachel Zillner. Hello. Rachel was, right before the break, was telling us about forming her escape room or puzzle room. So you did one on vacation. Did you guys do it with the kids, or was it adults?
Just adults.
Okay.
Escape rooms really aren't, I mean, there are some rooms that are designed for kids, but generally speaking, you want to be 14 or older. For some of the scary rooms, you really want to be like 16 or 18
scary.
And older. Yeah.
It's scary.
We don't do scary.
Is death an option?
Death is not an option.
Okay, good. That would be scary.
Although there are escape rooms in other countries that don't have the same kind of protection rules that we do here in the U.S.
Yeah.
And I have heard, like, you can actually choose the level of intimidation you want in your room. And I have actually heard a real report of an escaper in a room that got too close to the guy
with a, what are these called, chainsaws, and lost an ear.
Oh my god!
So that's in Germany, just saying, they got different rules.
Yeah, Germany's a little different. Yeah.
Wow!
But here, the scary rooms felt like that. In fact, in California, there's...
Our chainsaws are sterilized.
And they all have these great little protectors.
They're organic. Yeah. Everything is organic.
That's
organic,
right. Yes.
They're locally sourced.
It's organic oil on the blade. It's really good. Yeah.
It's great.
Yeah.
In Sacramento, there's only like one room that I'm even aware of that even has an actor, you know, that participates in the room. So that's a big thing in LA. There's a lot of actors.
Yeah, a lot of out of work actors.
Do you know that they're an actor, or they seem like
yes.
they're one of the people?
No,
oh.
you know, they end up being part of the plot. Right?
That's a good point. Yeah, when we did, you know, it was the six of us,
yeah.
and then a group of four, but none of us like assumed. I mean, I certainly didn't assume that maybe any of the other four might have been.
Right.
I mean, an interesting twist.
Yeah.
That's a thing, too,
yeah.
sometimes.
So trying to get you off the trail
yeah.
or whatever.
So you guys, after this, you said this was the funnest part of the vacation.
Yes.
And everyone said the escape room?
Well, no, just me.
Just you.
Yeah. Everyone else loved all the national history that we were covering on the East Coast. I was like, yeah, that's cool. What about
yeah.
the business?
You got an entrepreneur and you were like, aha.
So you're like
idea.
Scouting
yes.
out super
yes.
strong, right?
Yes. Great.
Well, and so it became this fun thing where I was like, this could be like a real business. Like, this obviously is here, but in my head, like, this could work. This could work. This could be the thing that we're looking for. And my brother found, we were home for like a week or two, and I'm still buzzing, and I thought they gave up on me, and, you know, I don't like to do things by myself. So I'm calling my husband on the way home, and he's like, did Mark send you the article? Which Mark's my brother. And I'm like, no, what article? He's like, oh, he found like this business journal article from like Idaho or something. I'm like, okay, what's it say? Well, there's this escape room in Idaho that opened and they made like $1 million the first year. And I was like, well, I gotta go. And my husband's like, wait, why? I'm like, I think you know why. I gotta go. And he's like, don't do anything without me. I'm like, at this point it's happening, so you're either in or you're out. And he's like, okay, you know. And I call my brother and I was like, yeah, so I'm doing an escape room. Either you're coming with us or you're not. He's like, oh, we gotta talk about it, you know. And he's like, I have to be the yin to your yang. And I'm like, oh, I don't. Okay, well, you're in or out. So he decided to be it, which was great. Because a week later, not even a week later, we were filling out our paperwork with our attorney to, you know, open this business. And then the weekend after that, we were signing paperwork on a lease.
Wow.
Like,
wow.
Let's do this, right?
Yeah.
I called my commercial broker. Let's go
and
get some property.
That? Where's the property?
In Rockland.
Okay.
On 5-star.
Okay.
You can see it as you're on your way to the Galleria Mall. And then we started on puzzle creation, which was way harder than I thought it was going to be. Like, way harder.
Now, tell us about, we were talking about that earlier, I was thinking about that. Tell us about that process. How's that come about?
Well, for us, it came about at a sushi restaurant in a party room with a whole bunch of paper laid on a whole bunch of tables and then a whole lot of laughing at each other, which later turned into anger. My idea's not stupid, you know. But eventually...
Yes, it is.
Right. Like, no one's going to get the jump from looking at the ceiling and deciding to put the word play in a lock over it. Like, duh. You know, but it's fun because... You know, sometimes it's making a mini version of what you're thinking. I mean, I'm so visual. The guys aren't as visual. They can just figure it out. So it creates a lot of, you know, continued engagement, we'll call it, around the
right.
ideas as they develop. And, you know, it's good, right? Like, for whatever reason, the three of us, it's panned out well because each of us brings a different thing to the table.
Mm-hmm.
I don't get tech at all. My husband's like a total nerd. He does all of our tech for all of our puzzles. My brother... does property, and not property, what am I talking about? Project management. So he's like always kind of in the operational side of it, and he's like literally the yin to my yang. So I'll say, this is amazing. He'll say, no, it's not. I'm like, what? You know, but he forces me to push it a little bit more, and I
right.
push on him to get out of his comfort zone.
Mm-hmm.
So together, the three of us do well. But there's been, I mean, the thing around escape rooms is you'll design something, and then you have to do what we call beta testing for escape
sure.
rooms, right? Like, you pick random friends and family members to subject to this weird stuff that you've thought of, and then you figure out that, oh, that doesn't actually work the way I thought it would.
Yeah.
Or that's
no
maybe too
it.
Hard, right?
Like, I thought you were smarter than that, friends.
You know, you'd love to blame them, but really you have to look in the mirror, right? But you have to, sometimes you can run, you know, 5 practices if you've done a really, really good job of editing your game, or other times we've done months of, yep, still not right.
Mm-hmm.
Or we thought we designed a game that would take 45 to 60 minutes, but instead it takes 2.5 hours. So cool. that's actually easier to scale back than it is to try and add something to a designed theme, right?
Yeah,
it's like,
so.
Oh, how are we going to fit that in there? Yeah. So.
And it's 45 to 60 minutes, the time frame you typically
We do 60
for.
Minutes. So when we first opened, we had a game that was 45 minutes. And that's pretty popular on the East Coast, but on the West Coast, everyone likes their full hour. So we retooled.
Really, the East Coast is already 45 minutes, but the West wants their 60.
And I would assume, like, here we're like about it, right? Like,
yeah.
Let's get it done. But nope.
People like escaping.
More like that. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, and that's the thing. Everyone wants to escape, but the fun part of the escape room is that most people don't.
Uh-huh.
Right? So, like, our rooms range from like around a 13% escape to about 40% escape, which means most people aren't getting out, but they have a ball doing it.
Really?
So, yeah.
40%.
Yeah.
Wow, that's interesting.
Yeah.
So is there a repository, international repository of escape room ideas or ones that have worked you can pull from? Hey, let's do what they did over in Japan 2 years ago.
I wish. There are like some great little like.
Started.
Oh, geez.
Don't tell her that. Her husband
like,
will find you.
He will.
Right.
No, there are places where you can buy escape rooms,
okay.
Right? And generally they're fully out of the bag, anywhere from 45,000 up to 105,000. It depends on, you know, what kind of experience you're looking for. Pick it up, plug it in, they'll put it in for you, you just have to run it. My issue with that sort of establishment is, I mean, great, right? Except if you don't understand what you built, it's really hard to fix it when it breaks. And people are really, really hard on things in escape rooms because the point is you're supposed to get out of the box,
yeah.
Right? So it's like, rawr, like I break things, you know? And if you can't fix it, then you're creating a less than exciting experience because, oh, well, that doesn't work tonight, or
right.
This piece is missing, or, you know. I mean, we learned in our first couple months we didn't have everything bolted down. Weird. People like pulled pictures off the walls or out of the walls or, you know, stood on things. And like, what do you mean? Like this 200-pound thing we had mounted moves. Oh, okay. It does. So earthquake straps are a real thing.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
So how did you pick your theme?
We tried to pick things that were already in the region.
Okay.
So we did a Sherlock Holmes themed room, a pirate themed room, and then like an Illuminati whatever room. But out in Vacaville, we also have a pretty swanky speakeasy themed room, which is pretty cool, and like a version 2 of our pirate room. As we continue to learn a little bit more, we do a little better each time, so they get more and more elaborate.
How many rooms do you have in Vacaville?
In Vacaville, we have 3.
Wow, that's great.
In Rockland, we have 4.
Wow.
And we just added, our Baker room, 221B. We made a copy of it, so we can actually have teams compete against each other at the same time.
Oh.
Which is kind of fun, right?
Yeah.
We've done a lot of birthday parties, and we have to put them in 2 different rooms. It's like, well, that's not fun, because they can't really talk about it with one another.
Right.
So putting that copy there, I think, is a fun
dynamic.
That's
a great idea. And how often do you change the theme, or do you?
Well, so I generally think you should change it after about 2 years. Like,
2 years
past ago. 2 years is too much. But since we've been in such a build space, we haven't come back. We have redressed puzzles and added things, but now we're just looking at building the new games. So I've got some pretty cool new games that have been vetted that we're ready for that will be coming to Rockland soon.
Awesome.
Right. Well, I will say, folks, if you're looking for a team building thing for your work team, we have done a couple of these,
really?
And it is such a great experience because you've got like your executive and then the IT guy and then the gal that works at the front desk and then the HR lady, and it's like, you know, everybody is engaged,
mm-hmm.
and it is really funny and bonding. Like,
mm-hmm.
you know, the person that's supposed to be in charge can't figure out the thing that the,
so
you know, part-time seasonal worker came in and she got it and nailed it. And like, it's just, it's like a big equalizer.
Yeah.
You just get to see each other as people,
yeah.
and it's no titles and it's no whatever. And
super
it's just
humanizing.
Such a bonding.
Yeah. In fact, we had, we laugh about this because, you know, we had a group from the FBI come out. Right, and they wanted to play our toughest game, so they played 221B Baker Street, and they didn't beat it. And I mean, they got hung up on the funniest things. It's like, well, that's not possible, so I can't try that. You know, well, these things are kind of like magic; they're full of tech, right? It's not the real world; it's the tech world.
Right, yes.
And so they didn't beat the room. And then we had a group, you know, we had a group come out from like Pete's Restaurant, right? And they kicked its booty, right? Like,
that's hilarious.
FBI.
Just saying. Okay, well, we're going to take a break. When we get back, we'll continue the conversation with Rachel Zillner, VP of Community Banking and Membership at Safe Credit Union. Listen beyond the numbers. set or segment, anything you specifically want to touch on?
I should, if we're talking about the escape room, I should mention that we're doing a fundraiser with Red Cross this month. Just because it's a chance to talk about giving back, right? And we're doing one next month with the SPCA. It's a good venue to do this sort of things with. But I don't know. I'm not sure what the, you know, what's the goal for me today.
The community aspect.
Yeah.
To talk about that. So, you know, obviously, what are you going to do with the escape room, but other ways that things you're involved in, causes, that kind of stuff.
Sure. Okay.
If you could talk a little bit about the, like, everyone thinks, like, we're holding it all together and it's like, whatever.
Girl, people, I forgot to brush my hair this morning. I walked out, I was like, I have a brush in the car.
Right? I think that always really resonates with folks. Like, it's not all.
And if people want to get a hold of you, what contact number do you have?
Okay.
Number, email, phone number. Address. Okay.
Yeah.
Which is
906-502-3439.
Okay.
RachelBTheRoom.com. That's easy. Okay.
We're back. Is this more driving music? You would have heard me through dad?
Not this one.
Oh, okay.
It's more Beach Boys.
Oh, okay. Gotcha. Sorry, Jerry. More Beach Boys. All right. So we're talking with Rachel Zillner, who is a VP Community Banking Membership with Safe Credit Union, also the owner, operator, and general runner of a couple different escape rooms here in Rockland and also now in Vacaville. When did Vacaville open?
July of last year.
Okay. July of last year. Excuse me, and then also doing many other things, including community involvement, which I'll touch on some, and then also something you want to touch on with keeping it all together.
Yeah.
And not keeping it all together.
I know. Well, yeah, we're going to have real talk sessions, so Stay tuned for that.
Okay, so quick things.
Yes.
On the escape room, one of the things we like to leverage it for is a way to give back philanthropically, right? So this whole month, we're doing a promotion with the Red Cross, that if you book a room using promo code Red Cross, you save 10% and then we give 10% to the Red Cross.
Excellent.
And that's a cool thing that we've done with a number of different nonprofits. Next month we're doing something with SPCA for a week or so, and we've done it with Leukemia Lymphoma Society. Like, it's just kind of a neat way to be different about giving back. Separately, I know we want to talk about how we manage to do all these things.
We do.
So Mark said owner-operator. That is not true.
Okay.
This is more of a passive investment, because we actually have a team of 18 employees who run the escape room, two managers that we have, you know, blessed to do whatever they think is right to run their businesses, because there's absolutely no way. I mean, my engagement with this place now, besides designing puzzles, is nightly emails I get from the managers that tell me everything didn't break, everything's okay, here's what we need. I mean, they have all the money that they need to buy the things that they need on random credit cards. Thank you, Safe Credit Union, for those. Because the reality is any one single human could not possibly do all these things.
Yeah.
In fact, I was joking with Amanda. I mean, I was serious, too. Like, I left the house this morning. I was like, I forgot to brush my hair. Like, I keep a hairbrush in my car and in my desk, and one of my coworkers has one, because, you know, you forget the weirdest things sometimes when you're trying to hold too many balls up in the air.
Absolutely.
And, you know, my priorities, which aren't necessarily in the right order, right, are my day job, right, because that's my day job.
Right.
And then after that, we'd probably put the escape room, and then maybe my children, right, and my family. And then after that comes the investment property and whatever's left there.
Right.
Like, I went to Massage Envy last night. I was so proud of myself. And on my way out, I was like, how many credits do I have? And they're like, 9.5. Oh my gosh.
You need to go.
That's like better part of a year, right? Like,
right.
I'm not figuring this out.
Right.
So, you know, I think a lot of people, there's so much buzz around balance, right? Like, we have to quit using that word, because it's not true, right? Like, I have yet to meet any woman who is successful or not who does balance, right?
It's like multitasking.
Yeah, you can't do that.
That's not a real thing.
It's a concept,
but no one does.
The only good multitasking I do is listening to my husband tell a story about work while working. And
He gets so mad at me. I don't understand. It's like the way I'm a good multitasker. Right.
So.
Well, and how long have you and your husband been together?
10 years, just
okay.
over 10.
Okay.
Right.
So, could you talk a little bit about? I mean, you've got little,
yeah,
you know, little
5-year-old. Yep.
Yeah, you've got children. You've got businesses. You've
yeah.
got your own thing. You've got. I mean, we didn't even talk about board service and civic stuff
sure.
and whatever.
Yes.
And a marriage that you're trying to manage and your
yeah.
physical, like,
yeah.
you know, how. What have you learned in your relationship that has made that be still married today?
You know, I actually heard some really good advice at a Metro Edge event. Like, shout out to my edgers. We do this thing called Executive Insight, and we put a bunch of local executives up on a panel, and we kind of like speed date with them. And really great advice I heard from one of the executives. In fact, he's the CEO of Raley's. He said, the first person I call when something exciting happens in my life is my wife. And I thought, oh my God, I'm so bad at that. I share that with like Facebook or like my coworkers
right.
or my mom or, you know, whoever first. And that actually made a really big difference. That intimacy that brought into like sharing that thing with him first was cool. Now, we did have a little chat about what being excited sounds like.
Yeah.
Because remember, my husband's a techie one,
right.
and I'm like the woo!
Yeah.
You know.
That's great, right?
Yeah, right? So, but it was cool because now I have to hold these things, you know, like, oh, I can't wait to tell you. But I do screw up sometimes because balance, right? He last night goes, hey, I saw you on the radio tomorrow. And I was like, oh, crap, did I forget to tell you that?
I told you that? Right?
Yeah, yeah. That worked with my dad, but not with my husband. Yeah. But it's just, you know, like right now my 3-year-old's at home because she has pneumonia, right? Like there are certain things that bring a new level of balance that you didn't expect, right? When someone falls ill, it's like,
oh, yeah.
stop.
Yeah.
You know, we just moved two weekends ago.
Oh, yeah.
I was supposed to be on vacation these 2 weeks. And this is absolutely what you wear when you're on vacation, right? Like you wear a blazer and heels because you're on vacation. No, because I've had 2 days off in the 10 days I meant to take off work because
right.
it's just too busy.
Yeah.
Right? Like right now with my new role at Safe, there's a lot going on and I'm too excited to back away from it. So
right.
I took back my vacation time. Now, my house feels more like an Airbnb than a new home right now, but, you know, I figure we'll get there. And, of course, we decided to get chickens, and I lost a chicken, like, the second day we were in the house. And
no!
That's actually how I met my neighbors. So I look really cool, like I've met my neighbors, but actually it's because I had to explore their backyards because I lost the dang chicken.
Did you find
the
chicken?
Hey-Hey ran away, but Hey-Hey came back.
Hey,
so
hey. Whereabouts you guys at? Where's your neighbor?
We're in Fair Oaks.
Okay.
Where they have
where
the
they chickens.
Have chickens.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
I wanted chickens my whole life. I thought it was, like, a cool thing. Now chickens are really messy. I get it. So far, we have one egg in
We've
2 weeks.
We've got people that I work with that have chickens, and they're always bringing in eggs to the office
yeah.
for people to.
I
want to
be one of those people.
You're
going to
be one of those
people. I feel like I need more chickens, right? But I will lose them. So. I don't know.
If you start like a chicken breeding,
yeah.
oh god!
I did a hamster breeding business when I was a young kid. I was always entrepreneurial.
Paper hamsters.
Everyone wants Russian dwarf hamsters
okay.
when you're 8 years old.
Yeah,
that was my first real business.
I think I have.
Are those the fluffy?
No,
they're like little teddy bears.
Okay,
so cute. I had a business partner. Don't like to do things by myself.
Yeah.
Her dogs really liked her hamsters. So it was the end of the business.
Oh,
I was
yeah.
wondering if that's what you're going to tell us about. Hey, but
Hey
came back. So.
Hey, made it back.
So how many chickens do you have?
We have 3.
Wow.
Yes, their names change a lot because my 3 and 5-year-old like to do that, but I'm keeping up with it.
Now, who throws out the scratch and who gets the eggs and stuff? Is that you?
The egg.
You're right,
one
that's
egg.
Thank you.
Which,
one egg.
This is so terrible, right? Like, mommy guilt right here. Like, I found the first egg. I was so pumped. I'm like, look, guys. And then my 5-year-old's like, Mommy, I want to find an egg. I'm like, oh, why did I not take her with me? What was I thinking?
Just leave it. Yeah.
So she carries a basket out every day. Can't find an egg. I don't know.
This is when you just buy some eggs.
Oh, God, that's such
and
a good idea.
One.
I
don't have the little egg EB stamp.
Right, just scrub that off. Pop them out there.
Oh, my God.
Oh, my God, you found an egg.
That's actually a really good idea. I'm going to do that.
Yeah.
Well, honey, are you listening?
Yeah.
Put an egg out there.
Tricking your children is one of the great joys in life.
Tricking your children.
And then they'll get old enough you can't do it anymore. So you gotta cash
yeah,
in.
Yeah, they wise up to it.
Yeah.
But I do think, you know, there's just so many things we try to do and connect. Like, I've gotten pretty smart about how I use that time. Sometimes when I do a one-on-one, I do it at a place where you can get a pedicure at the same time. Why not,
yeah.
right? Like,
yeah.
it's time, ladies. Let's do this. Mm-hmm. Or if I, like, Monday I needed to make sure my hair looked great for a headshot, so I did a blowout, and I did a one-on-one, the blowout, right? Like, and I've gone with some of my gals that have to go to Costco, and we just make these little, all right, well, let's take our one-on-one to Costco. I mean, my boss and I have been to shop for shoes for him on one of our one-on-ones, so, you know, you kind of fit these things in, or, hey, can you drop me off to pick up the car? Like, I think those things aren't so problematic, you know, if you have a job that has that kind of flexibility, you can do it. You make it work.
Right. Absolutely, yeah.
Yeah. One person's driving, the other one's taking care of business.
Right.
On the phone. So, you know, it doesn't work. Every now and then you have to call an all time out, fly out of the country where your phone doesn't work so you can't work, and actually be on vacation.
You know, one of our listeners on Facebook just said that he heard someone once called to try to shoot for a blended life versus family. I like that, because you're blending all the things.
Because
it varies for each person, right? I mean, what you blend is what you.
Yeah. Well, and it's so easy to get lost in all of the... I mean, Sacramento is a city that doesn't ever stop moving. I mean, our region is so vibrant. And I have to pick, like, a night a week or two nights a week that have to be home nights. Otherwise, you don't see your family.
Yeah.
Right? Like, the crock pot or the Instapot is the girl's best friend.
Yes.
Right? So I can still feed my family instead of McDonald's feeding my family all the time. Right?
Very good confidence.
Yeah.
Yeah. No, that is an excellent point to just, you know, schedule it in and put that time. You know, something, Rhonda Staley Brooks had given me this advice because, you know, she's kind of this, like, woman also that's doing a million things.
Superstar.
And, you know, like you say, you don't want to miss out. So, you know, there's an event every night of the week that you could go to, and they're all important, right?
Yes.
She had said, you know, you just put it on the calendar, and those are my family days.
Yeah.
Actually, Peter Tati, she said the same thing.
Yep.
Those are my family days.
Mm-hmm.
It's on there all month.
Mm-hmm.
They know that.
Yep.
You stick to that.
Yep.
And when something pops up, you ask your spouse, hey, here's this thing on Thursday. Do you mind if I go to that?
Right.
That is a great point, because my wife would tell you I did not do that often enough. I say, yes, I'll go. And then I'm like, hey, babe, by the way.
Yeah. And they support you, and they're going to say yes. Of course, but it's that you're my teammate,
right.
And I'm
going
to treat you as a teammate and not as an employee.
That's right.
Yes. Okay, here's what's going to happen. Well,
right?
we're done.
Wow.
Oh, so
time
fast.
Flies. We've been talking with Rachel Zillner, VP Community Banking and Membership at Credit Union, also owner of Beat the Room. You can get a hold of her, Rachel, at beattheroom.com or 906-502-3437. Thank you so much for being on the show again.
Thank you.
Love having you on.
Always.
And everyone have a great week. We'll talk to you next week.
All right. Drive safe. Right.
Take care. I don't know why I'm cuddling with this cord.
He's really liking it.
With that
this
cord.
Is my comfort cord.